my left are the council's planning officers, highway engineer and environmental health officer, who will present the applications this evening and give any technical advice to the committee which may be sought. The rest of the people who you see down both sides of the tables are the elected members who will consider the applications this evening and make the decisions. Before each application is considered, there will be a short presentation by the planning officers. In the event that an application has received a qualifying petition signed by 25 signatures or more, one representative of the petition will be invited to address the committee in support of the petition for up to 5 minutes. If a petitioner addresses the committee, then the applicant or their agent will be invited to make representations to the committee in support of their application, again for up to 5 minutes. However, if a petitioner has not addressed the committee, then the applicant or their agent will not be invited to make any representations. A ward councillor can address the committee in relation to an application. The ward councillor may speak on behalf of the residents. However, once the ward councillor has returned to the public gallery, they may not return to take part in any debate that may be followed by the committee. The application will then be open to debate and discussion by members of the planning committee, who will then make a decision on the application. If the site visit is requested and approved by the committee, then that matter will not be discussed this evening and will be discussed at a subsequent planning committee meeting. Members, can I have approval of the minutes on pages 1 to 8, please?
Site visits on item number 12, 7 and 9, West Road and Octorum. This has been subject of a refusal of this committee in the past, and it would be to the benefit of new members to visit the site before the decision is made.
Any others?
Are
members happy to approve those site visits? Agenda item 10, Land off Manor Drive, Upton. Agenda item and agenda item 12, rear of 7 and 9 West Road, Nocturne. So if anybody would like to leave now, then please do so.
Through you, Chair. This application was subject to a planned site visit on Tuesday. Planning permission is sought for the conversion of the former ESWA club into 11 apartments, together with the erection of 7 townhouses and 21 apartments. So if you just refer to this layout plan, this is the ESWA club, which is also referred to as 54 and 56 Park Road South. So that will be converted into 11 apartments. This is the area for the 7 townhouses, and then these 2 blocks would be the 21 apartments. The site sits within Birkenhead Park Conservation Area and adjacent to the park, which is a Grade 1 listed historic park and garden. The site is also within the primary residential area. The site also sits within Birkenhead Park Conservation Area. The use of the ESWA club as a social club ceased in 2012 and has remained closed and unused. It is a building identified in the conservation area appraisal as being one that makes a positive contribution to the character of that conservation area. Whilst the building itself is not listed, nevertheless it has significant value within the conservation area and has historical connections, having previously been home to a famous mountain climber. Its retention and conversion is therefore highly desirable, providing a positive contribution to the character of the area. Its loss would significantly undermine the conservation area, having regard to its architectural and historical significance. Having been closed and unused for some time, its appearance and overall fabric is beginning to fade, and these proposals are seen as an opportunity to retain and preserve an important building within the overall context of the conservation area. To this end, and to enable the restoration, conversion and retention of this building, additional development is proposed in the form of townhouses and additional apartments proposed at the rear of the site. The enabling development of 7 townhouses and 21 apartments has been independently appraised via a viability appraisal, which confirms the number of additional units proposed are needed to fund the restoration and conservation of the ESWA club through its conversion. The overall scheme, including the development of the new apartments and townhouses, has been developed in partnership with Historic England and the Council's Planning and Conservation Offices. The scheme has been amended to create additional spacing between the park and the proposed apartments, softening the potential impact of this element of the development. Additional landscaping is also conditioned. It is accepted that the redevelopment of the rear of the site will result in some harm to the conservation area. Late additions to the conservation area in similar locations have been allowed along the south and west boundaries. The amendments secured result in a scheme where the level of harm caused to the character and appearance of the conservation area can be justified and are outweighed by the benefits of retaining an important heritage asset in a viable use. Historic England have also confirmed that view from a heritage perspective. The Council considers that the applicants have worked with officers to deliver a proposal which limits harm to the conservation area and respects the setting of the adjacent historic park and garden, and would retain a building that is recognised to positively contribute to the character of the Birkenhead Conservation Area by virtue of its architectural and historic significance. On balance, then, any potential harm is outweighed by the benefits of allowing the development to proceed, and the application is recommended for approval. There is a qualifying petition of objection in also received a, an additional representation from Save Britain's Heritage. That came through on yesterday. And it reiterates many of the objections that were highlighted by the union groups.
Can I just check with the Matthew that there's nothing new on there? Okay, thank you. Okay, we do have a qualifying petition, but the lead petition on to come forward to speak? There should be a button that you can press just to tell you my preferred not.
The green one, I think it's interesting. Yes, green there before.
So if I could just ask you to state your name and your address, and if you just tell me you have 5 minutes to speak. I will let you know when you have 1 minute left.
Yes, I am Professor Robert Lee. For the last 20 years I've been chairman of the Friends of Birkenhead Park. I live at 5 Cavendish Road. This is really a very important issue for you and for everyone on the Wirral. What struck me is the response, both national, regional and local. As far as I know, there have been 17 submissions, some of them from really powerful and important bodies like ICOMOS UK, the Parks Agency, statutory consultees like the Gardens Trust, and in fact, submissions by 3 former conservation officers of the council, one of whom, Raymond. And why have we had this huge response? Because this is really an unprecedented application, particularly the enabling development on the Rio Grande areas of the park. Matthew has described the scale, but what is even more important is the damage it would inflict on Birkenhead Park as a key outstanding international asset. It has a unique heritage, which I'm sure you can all be aware of. The model for Central Park, New York, it's internationally significant. It's a jewel of national and world renown. And according to the Gardens Trust, and I quote, Birkenhead is arguably the most historically significant park in the UK. So you couldn't do better than that. But what people forget is that we're not talking solely about the park land, the area within the boundary of the park drive, but we're talking also about the garden areas, because those were specified in Paxton's plans. They were part of his vision. They were intrinsic to the layout of the park. And every sales plan drawn up by your predecessors specified the importance of conserving them as open landscape areas. They were to be used solely as a garden, and that's a conveyance which applies to number 56, Park Road South, and restrictive covenants still apply to the land in question, and a formal application would have to be made to the land registry. So how significant would this development be in terms of the damage that it would inflict? And the message from all these bodies is unanimous. It would be irreparable, severe and incredibly serious. 5456 was turned down for listing by what was then English Heritage. The links with Sandy Irvine were not reflected in the physical fabric. And the harm inflicted by refurbishing the unlisted heritage asset via the enabling development would be immense. Quote, it would have a serious and irreversible impact on the setting of the park, harm listed buildings, undermine the integrity of the Great Ormond landscape. Well, how have we got to this position? First of all, the conservation deficit assessment, and I suspect none of you have had any real experience in dealing with this. And again, the message for all the submissions is that what is being proposed, the enabling development, is not the minimum required to meet the conservation deficit. It is the minimum required to achieve a profit margin of 20% on the whole project. Profit margin that is well above the industry standard, and it's expected to generate just short of £800,000, probably more than that. We have found through examination that the conservation deficit is flawed, and I've submitted evidence to that effect, that the advice you've received from the planning department, again, is misleading, factually incorrect, and insubstantial, and we've sought legal advice on that. The consequences of allowing this application to go through would be very serious in terms of the World Heritage Site submission that we're drawing up with the council. According to the Garden Trust, the council should do nothing to jeopardise that submission, and ICOMOS, which is the key body which determines the outcome of World Heritage Site submissions, is explicit. It would demonstrate that effective conservation control cannot be guaranteed in this case, or generally, that it would represent such a poor management of the heritage asset that it would massively diminish the chances of the park being inscribed. So I would say you need to refuse this. The national, regional, local expert opinion is unanimous. It would cause irreparable damage to the setting of the park. It would be in breach of key planning policies. It's an excessive development. What we would suggest is that we go back and talk to
you. Sorry, I'm going to have to put you off there. We are skipped with our 5 minutes. We'll have to put you off there. Sorry.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Thanks. Thank you for your representation.
Thank you.
This would raise the absolute minimum needed for the ESWA building to be saved. To substantiate this, we provided a detailed financial breakdown, which had been independently examined by your officers, by a third party, Cllr, and by the applicant's own third party, indeed. This committee can rest assured that this is a robustly justified scheme, which has been tested by each professional surveyor, and was agreed upon it. Your own officers and Historic England have also confirmed acceptance. The design of the building has been subject to considerable discussion in London over the next 2 years, and these discussions have involved officers, historians, and the Friends Group, and which the President and Professor Leech for his input. The resultant scheme has evolved and been influenced by more latterly by Anne Boxer, the historian, who is probably one of the foremost conservation experts in the country on these matters. And she fully supports it. We've appointed a consultant, Emma Adams of Parliament, to produce a thorough heritage statement to justify the scheme with regard to both the impact on the conservation area and the garden and parking lot itself. Following discussion with the professor, which we've had several additional Your own conservation area appraisal identifies the building as making a positive contribution to the character of the conservation area. However, without intervention now, this contribution may be lost forever. The applicant is also first to understand to protect the park and fully supports the UNESCO bid, and it's clear that the development can be undertaken without harm to the setting of all the wider conservation area. We know the concerns of the Friends and the applicants have liaised with them for many months, well before submission of the application, but it must be stressed that this proposal is the only option to save the ESWA building. There is no credible or viable alternative either being offered by the Friends or anyone else. This is a scheme that historically fully supports, which has been carefully costed. It is an original, carefully crafted and entirely deliverable scheme. My client's a local resident, he attended Park High School and is now a successful local businessman. And he's long admired the ESWA building and understood its local significance. And following that fire, he purchased the building in March 2014, determined to save it. This is therefore a very personal venture for him. Members might also like to know that he's commissioned a corporate social responsibility policy statement and intends to set up a family unified home trust. This will provide funds to offer young people from the school free access to the Duke of Edinburgh and to provide financial support to enter higher education when possible. To reiterate, there have been no technical objections to this proposal, which have been extensively assessed by independent professionals and which follow sound professional, sound heritage principles. There are no reasonable grounds upon which the application could be refused. This is a fitting legacy to Sandy O'Brien's name, and all the team's family will be proud of the scheme before you, which will safeguard the ESWA for future generations to discover and enjoy. I urge you to support my client's commitment to save the support building and move the recommendation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Could I just ask you to turn the microphone off? Yeah. Can I also make a point, Chair? We issued an answer question with the plan that we present that.
Yes, we have obviously, but we've got the contract. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, the officers do have a copy of that, so I'll ask if they can put it up on screen to end the okay, can I open this up to committee? I've moved directly to that because I know there's more we can't say. Okay, Treena?
Just quickly, my committee fairly said you received a letter yesterday. Who that was from and what did it state?
Yeah, it was from an organisation called Save Britain's Heritage. And essentially it says, Save Britain's Heritage writes to object to this application which proposes the conversion of the former ESWA club into apartments. Whilst the principle of restoration and conversion of the derelict former club and undesignated heritage asset is to be welcomed, we consider this application amounts to overdevelopment of the site. It essentially repeats, I don't read it out in detail unless you want me to, but it essentially repeats many of those objections that have been listed by the other community groups and societies.
Is that clear for you?
Yeah, so that was Save Britain's Heritage, that wasn't the actual Heritage Association, UK Heritage Association.
No, it was an organisation called Save Britain's Heritage and they're based in Cow Cross Street in London.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Can I just say that I've really appreciated the efforts of everybody involved with this planning application, and to the degree that, in my mind, saying as a ward council, but someone who's appreciated very part of all this life and always will be, I must have changed my mind about 6-7 times. Every time I hear a piece of evidence, it is such a, I think, fine. Balanced application, and I know people say, well, it's not. And if I can describe my own feelings or my own perception of it, you seem to have almost the pragmatist versus the purist in terms of what the arguments and the debates are. The pragmatists are saying that this is the package that, after building been left for now 5 years, the only way of attracting the necessary investment is a package of this type. And whether this is the perfect package, I'll hold water on that. And then we have the people who do our garden, who we work with to protect the park, and its long-term ambitions of becoming a World Heritage Site. saying that it doesn't fit the bill. My understanding of the Paxton vision was the reason the park was built to attract investment around this perimeter of a high quality residential investment, and that was successful in the state of doing that. And the world has moved on. I then went on to look around the park about where these developments that have been allowed over the years have impinged and have come closer to what is the sort of protective boundary. And I have to say, there is something of a mishmash in certain areas of the park, but I don't, from recollection, remember, other than the school development, coming this close in terms of residential, this close to the actual boundary. Having said that, the boundaries around that area are not pleasant on the eye. I think we've seen on the tour, the visit, corrugated iron sheets and all sorts of things that are protecting the boundary. I actually, if that was what it looked like in the end, people would say that's not a bad outcome. But the outcome may jeopardise the long-term ambitions of the park. And this is where I find myself. And I'm genuinely, I've not yet come to a final decision in my mind. But the building itself is in such a state of repair. And we, as the authority, have demanded materials and renovation of such a high standard that there will have to be, to protect this building, I think we have to be pragmatic about it, as either today or at some future application, something, another development in the grounds of that area to enable that thing to be, unless philanthropist with money to bear actually comes in and does it as a kindness gesture. And there's not many of them around. And I certainly don't believe a council will be in a position to provide those funds. So it really is this dilemma in my own mind. My the gamble we take is that we either agree this and deal with the outcomes of it. If we refuse it, in a very short space of time, that building could fall down, could be subject to vandalism and another fire, and we potentially lose it forever. So it is that fine balance, and I wouldn't want to say, you know, I'd like to hear other people's debates and other people's opinions of what they felt about the site, and I haven't read all the documentation. So it really is, you know, talk about tough decisions you have to make on planning. Well, that goes with the job, and it really is a very difficult decision. And I'd say it is about the pragmatic versus the purist. I'm hovering between the two at the moment. I'll leave it at that for now, Chair. Thank you.
Is there anybody else who might ask some questions on this? And
Chair, yes, I very much feel the same way as Councillor Foulkes. He is, after all, a local ward councillor. There are other members from Birkenhead on this committee. I would welcome the fact that we went on the site visit yesterday. It was very useful. I have, in fact, been back to the park this afternoon to enjoy the drive around once again, just to see how I felt about it. I think we're all stuck with this, the pragmatic side of things, where we want to see the building restored, needing the money to do it, and then thinking in terms of what is the effect on this most significant historic park. And I am also very, very torn about that. But I think on balance I'm going to have to come down and say, having read all the submissions from the various bodies, I mean, significantly the first one, the latest, the garden just welcomes the restoration, but then you get all the other side of it. Should be regarded as key features within it, largely filled the garden of 54-56, with new housing, cannot be regarded as meeting the test of preserving or enhancing the character of the conservation area, unwelcome precedent, undermines the integrity of the park's surrounding landscape. 54-56 in itself is not a listed building. The park is grade one listed, arguably the most historic significant public park in the UK of international importance. They all go on the same name. And I just feel I really on that basis could not support this development. But I really would do want to hear what other people say.
Thank you, Chair. I completely agree with Steve. It's one of those that I've actually been there three times. I don't know Birkenhead Park very well, but I've travelled around this over a period of time. And we're damned if we do, we're damned if we don't. And we just don't know which way to turn. The big question is what comes next? What, whichever way we go tonight, is what comes next? I still haven't quite made up my mind over this. I'd like to listen to other people, but exactly what Steve was saying, I agree with. Thank you.
Pass.
Yeah, thanks very much, Chair. Yeah, it is a difficult one, isn't it? I mean, when I first read through the papers, I did form the impression that the enabling aspect of the application seemed rather excessive. 28 new dwellings on top of the 11 that would be incorporated into the existing building. When we went on the site visit, I did kind of, that did help a lot, and it did make me appreciate the size of the existing building, and it gives you some idea of the what would be required to restore it. You know, it obviously would cost an awful lot of money to do that, so it did kind of soften my views somewhat. I did notice on the papers that it's referred to on page 12, in the middle of page 12 from the Brighton Park Advisory Committee, referred to a previous site, which I think was also a social club, and is now Durris Court, which is about 500 metres from the application site. So that original building was knocked down, and they built Durris Court. And I went down and had a look at that, and it's a pretty nondescript, modern purpose-built apartment block. I suppose, you know, the applicant must have had always the option, given that this is not a listed building, to knock it down and build something new. And when I looked at Durris Court, I thought, well, God, I wouldn't really want something like that on this side. So I have to take my hat off to the applicant. I think it's already been said, I think they have worked hard to come up with something that would preserve the building. And I think the applicant is absolutely genuine
when we approach an application of this sort, it's obviously important that we take stock of all the evidence, and there's a mountain of it, isn't there, that we've been presented with opinions from all different sides. And when there's a judgment call to be made, I often find that there's a comfort, if you like, in our own policies, which is something to go back to and consider my opinions against the policies that that we have. And I appreciate our officers do that too, and to a large degree a lot of those policies are subjective when it comes to what do you think this development, what impact will this development have against the policy criteria that we have. Now, three policies are listed on page 14, which will be initially of relevance to us, some of which have been cited in the officer's report and in the representation we received on the addendum. There will be policies CH6, which deals with the Bedford Park conservation area, CH2, which deals with conservation areas in general, and CH26, which deals with the preservation of historic parks and gardens policy. I often like applications like this because you learn so much and realise that you have a policy specifically on gardens. And when you look at that policy, it only actually applies to two gardens, two areas that have gardens. That is Birkenhead Park, which, as we know, is a Grade 1 asset, and Thornton Manor Gardens and Thornton Park. They are the two significant gardens that, that we have specific policies on in order to attempt to protect them. So, with that in mind, and knowing that's the case, we obviously need to set ourselves a standard which we need to be satisfied that will be reached in relation to accepting or refusing an application. We do this for Green Belt, do this for green spaces, where again we set ourselves a bar. Now, reading through, for example, the preservation of historic parks and gardens, which as I say, only relates to two areas of our borough, that end up being one. We are asked to ensure that proposals would not involve the loss of features considered to form an integral part of the special character or appearance of the park or garden, as it relates to Birkenhead Park. Specifically, it's named. So this isn't gardens in general. This is the gardens that go down to Birkenhead Park and gardens in Thornwood. Those are only two. We are invited in the reason justification to ensure that we protect the garden parks and the gardens when determining planning applications. So that's the first port of call that I would consider. So far as the Birkenhead Park conservation area policy is concerned, it does talk about preserving uninterrupted tree-lined open vistas within the park from the Roos Park Drive. As we call the gardens specifically, I take that to mean both sides. The recent justification goes on to restrict the uses which would, by their nature or design, prejudice the landscape appearance of the area, invites us to restrict new developments falling within areas of open land bordering the park drive in order to preserve the open landscape setting in such a park area. The general policy, as you would imagine, slightly more general, I'm not quite specific, and references about conservation area policy as the key policy in general. So, having seen the application, having read the officers and laws and the policies that go with it, the question is as much what I think, it's what the policies say I should think, or the bar, the hurdle that I need to be satisfied. And like Pat, I think the final conclusion I have to reach is that the development that's proposed breaches those policy positions. Now, we haven't got a policy on plan applications within World Heritage sites because we don't have a World Heritage site. But we are keen, I think, as a whole council, almost, that we do move down that route. And I have noted, as Professor Lee invited us to, the comments from the International Council on Monuments and Sites, who are a special advisor to UNESCO on these issues. And I don't think, you know, further say as well as I say, so what? I don't think we should underestimate the significance to Birkenhead and the world as a whole of having a World Heritage site within our borders.
that building to that historic England, whereas they were then English heritage, didn't accept the links with Sandy Irvine, were strong enough in terms of actually listing that building itself. But nevertheless, because of what's in the conservation area,